Hey, what's going on? It's Bill Byrne. It's time for the Thursday afternoon just before Friday. Monday morning podcast, and I'm just checking in on motherfucking you. what's going on? I'm in the middle of this acting job over here, so I got to do this before they pick me up in the sad van. The sad van that takes you to set for the excitement. That's the rules. If you're going to have that much fun pretending to be somebody else, right? Winning bar fights and all the shit you get to do as an actor. All the shit you can't do in real life. Then, yeah, they got to pick you up in a sad van. The van is basically a bare bones, usually all white, with the gray vinyl interior, just completely like, you know, four wheels, powertrain. This will get you there. I call it the sad van. I don't know why. But that is the one thing about it. Great thing about acting is you get to do all this shit that you don't get to do in real life, you know, which is what's kind of cracking me up lately about action movies is how I don't know when exactly the action hero genre started, but I came up in the 80s. So, you know, you had Stallone, you had Schwarzenegger, you had Jean-Claude Van Damme, and then you had Steven Seagal. And each year they tried to, you know, Chuck Norris. And each year they just tried to fucking... Chuck Norris actually walked the line from, like, action hero and karate guy, right? He was somewhere between, like, Bruce Lee and I don't know what. It's a fucking Chuck Norris, I guess. Sorry, my brain is fried. We've been working long hours here. But anyways, those movies kind of already started off ridiculous. You know, we'd have 40 guys with a machine gun, and a guy would just fucking... There's one movie where I think it's Schwarzenegger. There's like 20 guys with machine guns shooting at him, and there's all these potted plants, and he just runs and kind of puts his hand up, you know, to guard his face from all the thousands of bullets that are coming at him, and somehow they miss him. He runs across this fucking foyer. I mean, they just kept getting more and more ridiculous, you know, all the way up to, like, Steven Seagal. Well, he would barely be moving and just beat the shit out of an entire bar. I love when they would throw a punch at his face and he would just sort of lean and just actually watch the fist go past his face. So now, just when you think that, you know, and the dialogue was always really bad. So then what they did... You know, they all went away because they just got so ridiculous. They kind of just stopped making action movies for a long fucking time. I think they did anyways. I guess the Bourne Identities and those were action movies. Whatever. All I know is that now they got the lady starring in them. And for some reason, like, I think just because people were so educated to how fucking stupid they were, they actually finally decided to start writing decent dialogue, you know, as opposed to all the shit they gave... Stallone to be like, go for it, right? Or what's his face? Schwarzenegger would rip off a steam pipe and throw it through somebody's chest and then be like, let off some steam. I mean, it was literally that bad. Don't wake my friend. He's dead tired. Just really bad. Then they started actually writing scripts. And I guess you had like the Bourne Identity. And then you had the other guy, Lock, Stock, and Four fucking Who's Him or What's This. And so now they got the ladies are doing them. And they're actually writing good scripts. But, you know, it is kind of funny to watch a woman, like, beating the shit out of two fucking 400-pound guys. I mean, doesn't it get to the point where it's like, I don't give a fuck how much karate you know. Like, I could just sit on you. Because that's the latest one. The latest one's like Atomic Blonde. And they got to pick smaller guys. Because it immediately takes me out of the movie. Like, Jesus, what the fuck? Come on. Really? You know what I mean? As badass as those women are in the UFC, they still fight other women. Because, you know, and there's still weight classes. Because at the end of the day, if you're tall enough and you're fat enough, you can eat a lot of those punches. Then you just smother him. Remember that? Like when your older brother would sit on your chest and you'd be getting claustrophobic, like, mom, like that. They could just do that to you, and they would win. I gotta keep my voice down.
Yeah, they would just win the fucking fight. So I'm not trying to be a party pooper here. I'm going to go see Atomic Blonde, but it is getting to the, it's a common, you know what it is? It's a combination of those kinds of movies and then all those feminist T-shirts that I saw this week that's really starting to fucking annoy me. It's like, do they think they're dumb enough that they're going to get into my fucking head with this shit? You know, I told you guys about that T-shirt I saw, right? This woman was walking around with this T-shirt. It said, a little boy, a strong woman scares a little boy, but excites a man. Like, what kind of guy would fall for that page one horseshit psychology? Like, I'm going to be, oh, I want to be considered a strong man. It's like, hey, lady, how about you say something fucking impressive? Did I already talk about this already on Monday? I can't remember. Anyways, yeah, it's like, why don't you fucking say something impressive? You know, instead of having your T-shirt warm up the crowd. I can't remember if I told you guys this already, but I wanted to make a T-shirt that says a real woman isn't afraid to make her man a sandwich every once in a while. Just to get the looks.
See that right there, ladies? That's exactly what we're talking about.
What are you smiling about, Nia? You like that one?
You singing the same old song again?
Huh?
You singing the same old song again?
Am I singing what same old song again? What is my same old song, Nia?
Your same old fucking song.
Your same old, ooh, I don't like when women do stuff and say things and have feelings. You're still singing that same old
song? No, I don't. No, that's not what I'm saying.
You old man.
That's not what I'm saying.
Prehistoric caveman. Have you evolved at all in the time we've been together? Or are you just singing the same old song?
Oh, well, if you'd let me finish.
I heard everything that you said. All right, I heard you said trash the T-shirt.
Isn't that T-shirt a little ridiculous? I mean, if I had the male version, like, you know, a real woman would blah, 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 no, blah, a little.
Your take on it is actually very funny. But yeah. Still, what were you talking? You were talking about how, the women in the action films, like, beating up, like, big guys. But you're willing to suspend your disbelief that Vin Diesel can drive a car through not one, but two or three buildings in Fast
No,
and
no, I'm not.
And be fine.
No, I'm not.
And be like, whoa, that was quite a ride, or whatever it is that he's
Yeah,
said.
No, it's stupid. No, it's absolutely stupid. They drive from one building to another and fishtail before them. It's completely stupid. I don't watch those movies.
Right. So I'm just saying, with all action films, you got to suspend your disbelief a little bit. Daniel Craig can't beat up like 20 guys at one time.
No.
But in the movie, he does.
No. Yeah, but here's the thing. What they did was, they started in the 80s, and it was immediately ridiculous, and the dialogue was horrific. Mm-hmm. So then what they did was they started to have better dialogue. And they actually have the guys get hurt a little bit, where, like, you know, fucking Bruce Willis had his bloody foot mm-hmm. on the glass, and his wife beater just kept getting dirtier and dirtier. So they tried to make him real. But I'm just saying, when I was watching that Atomic Blonde, she's, like, beating the shit out of these two guys. They're, like, 260 pounds each. Those guys,
yeah.
Once they get their paws on you, I don't give a if somebody outweighs you by 100 pounds, once they get their hands on you, it's fucking over. Right. And there's two of them.
But it's a movie. So we go with it, right?
I know, but it just gets to... There is a certain level. Like, there's a bunch of them. Like, I never used to watch The Bourne Identity just because the way they would edit it. I went to one of them. I swear to God, I almost had a seizure.
Yeah.
The editing was like that... What was that? That one that Woody Harrelson did? The murderers, the boyfriend-girlfriend murderers?
Natural Born Killers.
Yeah, the way that was edited, it was just like, you know, this is fucking, I can't watch this.
Right, the quick cuts.
Yeah, but that's what we're talking about. You're so bombarded with images. I get it. Slow the edits down, please.
Right.
Yeah, there was one, Matt Damon was like fighting a guy inside a bathroom, and like his elbow would go back, they follow that through the wall, and then back through the guy's head. It's like, Jesus fucking Christ. You know, if these NFL running backs are like, can't even move until Tuesday, the level of fighting that this guy would do on just like every 6 hours.
Oh my God, wait, did you see that video, speaking of NFL running backs, of the ex-NFL player who ran through that plate glass, that glass door, and his wife thinks he's suffering from some, like, you know, post-traumatic stress in his brain? It's called something, CTE. Did you see that video?
No, but I'm trying not to laugh.
He literally sprints through a glass door, and he doesn't remember doing it.
Don't laugh. It's sad.
It is definitely sad, but it is fucking hilarious that he's just like walking into a dental office, and all of a sudden he just hears 1649 blue, blue said, hot, 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 and he just fucking fucking runs through it.
No, that shit, it's ruining their brains. Like, isn't that like, what are they gonna do? What are they gonna do?
Did he spike his wallet after he went through the window?
No, because he fell down after he crashed through the glass.
Was he just walking with his wife and all of a sudden he just fucking mid-conversation?
I feel like he was talking to police or something about something. Maybe he was having some sort of episode and then he just took off and he ran right through this like glass door like at a grocery store.
Was he black or white?
Black.
All right, he's talking to the cops. Yeah, that's probably some shit from his childhood. You can't blame the NFL. I thought the cops don't treat you guys well.
He ran through a glass door, and he doesn't remember doing it. So his wife was like, I think he's got, you know, his brain is all fucked up from playing football. So what are they going to do about that? Can they put more padding in the helmet? Or, like, how?
No, because what it is your brain sits in fluid. So it's going to take some fucking, like, crazy brainiac to have, like, something that somehow keeps your brain stationary. The helmet fucking moves. Mm-hmm. But your head doesn't, so your brain doesn't smash against it. I mean, personally, if I was O.J. Simpson's lawyer back in 1994, that's what I would have said. I would have said O.J. suffers from CTE. He had been watching the Cooking Channel or this Ginsu knife commercial, and he just got a little confused.
Right. Well, whatever you would have
called it. Ron Goldman looked like Vince Ferragamo, and he never liked the Rams. I mean, that's the best I could have come up with.
Sure, sure. Well...
It's a comedy podcast. If you bring something up, what am I supposed to do?
No, I'm laughing.
Okay. On the inside.
On the inside.
It's an inner cry, bitch.
It's an inner cry, bitch.
Nia, did you see that? You want to see? Okay, now if we're going to just talk about horrible fucking things, did you see that fair, that carnival out there in Ohio where somebody went on like one of those tilt-a-whirl rides and the fucking thing snapped and all these poor people went flying through the air. One person died. This little girl was laying on the ground. It's one of the most horrific things I've ever seen. And then, like, investigators are looking in to see what the problem is. It's like, you know what the fucking problem is. They don't maintain those things.
Yeah.
I used to go to that, I don't get in trouble here. It rhymes with seven and a homophobic slur. No. I should say, I'm going to do one, six... homophobic slur.
What?
Come on, you don't know that one?
You used to go to a what?
What do you wave? What is a country wave?
Flag?
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, so I went there and...
Oh, God.
So I went there.
Seven banners.
Seven banners. For seven brothers.
Why can't you say where it was? You think they're going to, like, not...
I mean, it happened. I was at the one in that rhymes with Ringwheeled, Massachusetts, and I was on the roller coaster, right? Yeah. And we got off it, mm-hmm. And the time it took us to stand in line in the ride next to us, we lined up. You know, the line moved twice. We mm-hmm. just heard bam,
yeah.
And the roller coaster that was ending the ride did not stop and rear-ended the ride in front of it, and this mm-hmm. woman broke her cheekbone. Do you remember the time we went to that other one that rhymes with six homophobic slurs out in New Jersey, and we were in that Superman roller coaster, and yes. we got like we were waiting to get off it, mm-hmm. and then it wouldn't move, and then we were stuck
stuck. Yeah, it was ridiculous.
For a horrific how many minutes?
Yeah, it was like 30 minutes.
No, it wasn't 30. It was probably like 4 minutes,
it
5 minutes.
Like 30 minutes.
Might have been like 10, but I was sitting there, and I felt you starting to freak out.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, well, if I wanted to, I could wiggle my way out of this. And the second I couldn't move, all of a sudden I started feeling shortness of breath. And I was like, hold it together, Bill. Hold it together.
I can't believe we actually went to that place. Like, I assume that was my idea. I don't think you would ever suggest going to a theme park as a date.
Nia, weren't you the one that taught me that macaroni and cheese is not a main dish?
Yes, I was.
Yeah. I'm this weird combination of, you know, professional white collars and white trash.
Oh.
Yeah, we weren't good with money.
There was a period we were not good at money. So we used to have a tray of macaroni and cheese with toast.
Yeah, that's not a meal.
That was fucking delicious. The Kraft frozen, you just throw it in there.
Oh, God, how dare you?
Oh, God, white people don't know how to make macaroni and cheese. It's pasta. It's from Italians. So you can only take 50% of the credit.
Italians would be offended that you use Kraft macaroni and cheese. Wait a minute. Italians, do they make macaroni and cheese? That's not their thing.
Yeah, it is.
Macaroni and cheese.
That's one of the, you meet an Italian, that's one of the first things that they say when they meet them.
No.
You want some macaroni and cheese.
Maybe spaghetti.
Chip of beef on toast.
Now, remember when
chicken
you,
a la king.
You made fun of me because I was like making a jet. We went out to dinner the other night and I was sort of like lovingly doing this kind of like.
No, you weren't.
And now, and it was
because we were in. Okay, first of all, I'm on my podcast and I'm just being silly. Now, if you did what you did in Little Italy the other night in this apartment, I would have laughed. Uh-huh. We were sitting there, right? I took Nia to, we got this restaurant when I first met my lovely wife. I took her to like 10 years ago, right? So I'm trying like all day
longer than that.
Yeah, saying let's, whatever, saying let's fucking go there. She's like, oh, I want to go to the Stone Cone Creamery and fucking, what's that other stupid burger place that everybody eats like it's crack?
What, Shake Shack?
Yeah, Shake Shack.
Like I this. Didn't say I want to go to Shake Shack over this. Anyway, whatever. Just tell the story. We go
you
to
want,
dinner.
She wanted to go to some shiny place. And I wanted to go to the fucking old school home style. You know, you order like chicken parmesan. It's like, is that, how long did you hammer this, that this is only one chicken breast? This is like 9 chicken breasts. Mm-hmm. And then you fucking plow your way through it. You wish you didn't eat it. But it was delicious. Mm-hmm. So we go there. And they're playing all this Italian music, right? They got Dino on. When the moon hits you, I like a big pizza pie. That's amore. Mm-hmm. And then Nia does, you know that thing that, you know, in Hollywood movies when an Italian likes something, when he puts his thumb between his index and his middle finger, brings them together with both hands.
And like, he's going back and forth.
Back and forth. Like, that's a good a pizza sauce. So the song's on, and Nia starts doing that at the table, sticking her bottom lip out like, hey,
but
like,
I'm doing so, it in a fun way because I'm bouncing along to the music because they were playing. And I was like, you know, I was just doing the whole.
And I said, Nia, what if we were up in Harlem in some soul food restaurant, okay, and they started playing some fucking R&B or whatever the fuck you guys are listening to, and I started to doing a bad version of some break dance and shit, sticking my bottom lip out, you'd be like, if you don't stop fucking doing that, and you're sitting there with a white man, Nia. Huh? What do you think? What do you think would happen? I'm saying, just show. Hey, it was out of respect.
So it was culturally insensitive of me to do that?
I didn't give a shit. I thought it was funny, but I didn't need the waiters. We still hadn't gotten all of our food, so I didn't need you fucking with our food.
Listen, they had the whole rack of glasses and stuff, like, right by the window, like, right behind where we were sitting. I mean, come on.
Can I ask you a question? If I took you to Chinatown.
That food was delicious, though, by the way. Delicious.
Delish.
Delish.
Now, if I
it
took
was
you
fucking
to.
Fucking delish.
If I took you to Chinatown. Okay, and they were playing, you know, what
I mean, what wouldn't, because apparently that's offensive.
Okay, then they started playing, hi, yeah, 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 yeah. No, if you were, if they started playing some.
Everybody was kung fu fighting?
Yeah. What would you be doing?
I go, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, start doing the. Everybody was kung fu fighting.
And it would be offensive. All right. I mean, I don't know.
I'm not trying to be political correct, guy. I'm just trying to get people not to spit in my food.
Right.
That's all I'm trying to
but
do
I
here.
But I wasn't like talking to the waiter like, hey, Baizan, bring me some more.
Hey, fucking Vinny.
Gabagool. Like, I wasn't trying to do that shit like I was on the fucking Sopranos. I wasn't doing that. All right. I mean, your point is made.
Yeah. My point is not about being culturally sensitive. It's about having people not fuck with your food. Okay? You want to do that on your own? Okay?
Do it on your own time.
You want to go in and get a bagel and be like, oi, vey, with a lady. You're going to get an everything bagel like you never had before, if you know what I mean there.
And I mean everything.
Oh, boy. Oh, boy. Is that a matzo ball there? Anyways,
you gotta wrap this up.
No, I don't have to wrap it up because I've only been doing 20 minutes.
Oh.
I gotta read some I gotta read some advertising.
I'm gonna read some advertising sometime, but I know I'm not supposed to because.
Why aren't you supposed to?
Because they want you to read the advertising. No one's paying for me to read it. They want you to read it.
Yeah, everybody knows that. Why did you have to bring that up?
I know, but I'm just saying I want.
Is this some weird woman thing trying to mind fuck me into getting?
Yes, that's exactly.
You're gonna put it on a T-shirt.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Yep.
Here's a great one that she pulled on me the other night. We were laying in bed. And all the lights were out, and we were both tired. And there's a lamp, like, across the room sitting there. She's like, how do you turn that lamp off? And I'm like, I don't know, Nia. You get up, you walk over, and you turn it off. Like, oh, I'll show you. How dumb do you think I am? I am dumb. I'm not that dumb. Hey, Nia, go take some karate classes and beat up all my tall friends. I want to see that. All right, the black tux, everybody. See this, Nia? This is another progression for your people.
What are you talking about?
It used to just back in the day, it used to just be the white tux.
Oh, God. No.
No? This isn't one of those things?
Let's see how you can get through this read. Okay. Read it nice and slow so you don't mess up. Aww.
Hey, you can make fun of me all you want, but you married me. That's you hitched true. Your wagon to this. Listen to what you hitched your wagon to. The black tux. You know, there's only so many opportunities in life to wear a tuxedo.
That's true. A tux.
So, when your big day or special event rolls around, or if you have to go to court, you got to go to court. That's a good move. Show up in a tuxedo. Your Honor, may I approach the bench with my cummerbund? So, when your big day or special event rolls around this summer, look just as great as you feel with suits from theblacktux.com. With high-quality rental suits and tuxedos delivered to your doorsteps. Oh, delivered to your doorsteps. Sorry, that was all in capital letters. The Black Tux gives you a new way to rent.
Why do you keep putting the emphasis on the?
Oh, because I always watch football, and they go, The Ohio State University.
Okay.
Only the capital letter ones, and I'll yell the capital letter ones, right? Plus, with their free home try-ons, you get to see the fit and feel the quality of your suits months before your event. And the best part is, it's completely done online. What fucking cokehead wrote this shit? No, this is the best word. No, that's the best word. All right, theblacktux.com lets you create your look or choose from tons of stylist selected outfits. Dude, there's really only like three. It's the black one, the white one, and the gray one. Suits like these usually retail for $1,200, really. But at The Black Tux, they start at just $95. Why does this itch? If you have any questions or issues, their expert customer care team has your back every step of the way, no pun intended. After ordering your suit will arrive 14 days before your event. If anything is less than perfect, The Black Tux will send you a free replacement right away. When your event's over, just drop your rental back in the mail. Mm-hmm. Jesus, in the mail? You're going to fold it? How many times you fold that to get in that through a little slot?
You know people are just going to stuff it into an envelope and send it back in horrible condition.
Those smelly socks all wadded up.
Chicken marsala stains all over it.
God knows what else. Hey, Nia, guess what? Shipping is free both ways. How easy is that? Stand out at your event for the right reasons with The Black Tux. Call to action. To get $20 off your purchase, visit theblacktux.com/burr. That's theblacktux.com/burr for $20 off your purchase. All right, LegalZoom, everybody. Come on and zoom, 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 ah, zoom. Do you remember that show, Nia? Come on and zoom, ah, zoom, ah, zoom, ah, zoom. Kids show. Come on, give it a try. We're gonna show you just why. We're gonna teach you to fly. Hi. Come on and zoom. Come on and LegalZoom. All right, LegalZoom. Summertime is here. That means it's time for family vacations, sunscreen, and barbecues. But the most important thing to do this summer is prepare for your family's future with an estate plan from LegalZoom. Exactly. What if the hibachi blows up in your face there? The next thing you know, somebody doesn't have a father. Sorry. National Make-A-Will Month is right around the corner, and that's the perfect time to make sure you're prepared for the future. Who do you have to pay off to have the month be about you, you know? When they're like, today is National Pancake Day. Somebody lobbies for that. And how relieved are those senators, you know? Usually there's some sort of bill that's literally going to fucking kill children in some godforsaken place. This next bill is about pancakes. And for once, people with red ties and blue ties can all get along. Because who doesn't like pancakes? It helps to know what your options are. LegalZoom is not a law firm. But their network of independent attorneys available in 50 states can work with you to make sure you're getting the right estate plan, whether that includes a will or living trust. They'll provide specific advice to address the needs of your family. Plus, during National Make-A-Will Month, LegalZoom's pulling a bunch of helpful resources together. All in one place to make it a little easier to ensure your family and assets are protected. Call to action. Keep listening. We'll have more information in August. And to find out more now, check out LegalZoom.com for special offers that are coming your way. If you have a family, whether you're still with them or you abandoned them or you own anything you care about, you won't want to miss out. In the meantime, save more by entering BRRRR at checkout at LegalZoom.com, LegalZoom.com. All right, mercifully we're through that. How about the Red Sox? They finally won after dropping four in a row. They lost the last two to the Angels. They lost the first two to Seattle before they finally beat the fucking Mariners. And the Yankees starting to surge. They're only a game and a half out, you know, which is crazy because there's only like 50 games left. How much time have I done here? I gotta get going because this sad van. Yeah, you familiar with the sad van that takes you to the set?
You know? The 15 pass?
Yeah, the 15 passenger.
Yeah.
All white, gray vinyl, you know?
What about it?
I don't know, I always find it depressing.
Why?
I always like the union guy that.
Because that means you're going to set.
Yeah, I know. But they could have, you know, they couldn't get like the fucking. The cloth seats. Everything's just, you could beat the shit out of the inside of the, everything's just plastic.
You're not excited to go to your Sex and the City remake? What you doing?
I know. Yeah, I'm playing.
But it's an all male version of
No,
Sex
I'm
and the
playing
City.
Cynthia Nixon, and she's transgendered.
I love
she always,
Cynthia Nixon.
She always related male. And,
Cynthia
somewhere
Nixon
during
was the best actress on this.
You know, it's
show.
Great if you transition from. No, wait a second. If you transition from woman to a man.
Yes.
All right. Can you go bald then?
Maybe.
Like if they start giving you male hormones.
I don't know.
If you get the good hormones, can you be like, listen, I want the fucking who's got the great full head of hair? Who's got the Kennedys always had great heads of hair?
Right.
Yeah, like you get the Kennedy gene.
I don't know.
Hormone. Can they do that yet?
That's not an arena I'm willing to step into. I'm not willing to step into that conversation because I don't know anything about
Why?
It. Because
I'm not saying they can't join the Coast Guard.
Well, Trump did.
I know, that's what I'm saying.
Oh, yeah, it was the joke. Okay, sorry.
Isn't that a good thing though?
No. Who the fuck cares?
I wish he banned redheads from going to war. I'd be like, woo! My man, I'm voting for you again. Hey, can you vote for me now that I don't have to pay taxes? How about that? Oh, good. I don't have to go down to some godforsaken boot camp and get screamed at by some fucking guy whose mom never hugged him. I get it. Where I'm from, livestock and homosexuals are from. I understand, sir. Wow, look at all the extra stripes you have on your shirt versus mine. Why in God's name would I want to go do that? Huh? To get a free pair of Timberlands? I would definitely be that guy if I was in the military, who at the end of my hitch, whatever the terminology would be, I would definitely be the guy who takes apart his weapon and starts to mail it home bolt by bolt. That's why I didn't join. I would do some dumb shit like that. I try to figure out how to take apart a grenade so I could be the hit at the 4th of July party. All right. What do we got here? 29 minutes and 54 seconds. All right. I'm contractually obligated to do 30 seconds. I mean, 30 minutes. All right.
Contract?
Huh?
Whose contract?
I have a contract with the people.
Oh, the people's contract.
Yes, I have a people's contract. I told them back in 2007 that I was going to make podcasting great again. Hey, how much money do you think Obama's making tonight?
What's he doing
tonight? Oh, dude, he's got a tour that's bigger than Kevin Hart. Actually, I don't think he is. I think Kevin's still making more. He has a $69 million tour he's doing.
Really?
Giving rah-rah speeches to corporations. You know, 1,000 points of light. He's getting his bribe money, Nia. Him and, what's his wife's name, Penelope?
How dare you? Her name is Michelle.
Michelle, I know. She tweeted so much, I should have known what her name was.
Don't ever disrespect Michelle Obama.
Yeah, why are they trying to act like the wife of the guy who's actually doing the job is so goddamn important now? I don't understand that.
All around the world, same song.
Huh? Who's Martha Stewart dating? I don't know what the fuck he does. When's the last time you heard Stedman say something on Twitter? Huh? I'm telling you, those ladies, they got their bitches in line. I'm just fucking around. Hey, Nia, do you want to make fun of my hat before we go?
Oh, my God.
Okay, so let me do the... Let me get...
No, I'm going to tell the
backstory.
Bill fucking bought... a sassy Midwestern mom New York tourist hat, and it's the most ridiculous thing. Can I please take a picture of you in it and tweet it?
Yes. Well, this is what happened. I'm as bald as Charlie Brown. Actually, he has that one curly cute thing. And the sun was out. Tomorrow, the sun was out, and it was just fucking a hot New York day, and I didn't have my hat because I fucking worked out with my Nike hat, and I needed one. Because I actually used to think, you know, I'm so pasty that if I got a little bit of sun, that would be good. Mm-hmm. But it's bad.
Yes.
It's bad because you come in, I come in red. And they're like, what the fuck do we do with this? So I had to put a hat on so I didn't fuck up my Cynthia Nixon acting gig here. And so, you know, all they have this time of year is they just have all these New York City hats. I'm down in the village. So... I was in a bind, and they didn't have a mirror, and I bought it. And it's like literally, you know those shirts Jay Leno wears with the jean.
It's denim.
Like
it's
denim. It's a denim hat.
Denim New York City hat, and it's the kind of hat that a white Midwestern mom would wear and be like, "Ooh, I got a hat from New York City. Look, kids, I got a hat, like a baseball hat, like you guys have. Like that's exactly what this hat is."
The woman on set was making fun of it. I said, how awful is this hat? She goes, it's pretty awful. I go, look at this cool T-shirt my wife bought me. I go, and I just ruined it with this hat. And she goes, pretty much. Like, she was giving me no daylight. She wasn't, there was no out, nothing. All right, through the MM podcast, we'll tweet out a picture of my awful hat.
There you go.
All right, fuckos, enjoy the music. Transitioning into an extra 30 minutes here of a greatest hits from a Thursday afternoon just before Friday, Monday morning podcast from a Thursday afternoon that went by but is no longer here but will never be forgotten.
Another shot. Whoa. Moves highly styled, carefully afraid, becoming something that they're not. Strange old crowd, got a little too familiar now.
Hey, you know what? People wanted me to talk about Jay-Z and Solange or...
Oh, the elevator fight.
Whatever the hell her fucking name
Solange,
is.
Solange, that's her name.
I'm sick of Jay-Z wearing that Roger Moore tuxedo. We get it. You're fucking cool. Enough already.
Tom Ford.
Oh, is that what that is?
Always.
Yeah, I don't fucking know. I always feel at this point, Jay-Z's so famous, you forget he's from Brooklyn. Mm-hmm. And he fucking grew up in a street corner and can still beat the shit out of you, you know? Although, him with his shirt off, you know? I don't know. He's definitely a businessman.
Yeah, exactly. He's fine dining. He's eating like steak and wine and like croissants and
he
shit.
He is not
like,
P90X-ing.
Yeah,
I can tell you that.
He doesn't need to do all
he's
that.
He's got the gift of gab.
He doesn't need to do all
he
that.
He doesn't. He doesn't. You know what? I've had enough arguments with people. God bless him in his Roger Moore tuxedo.
Did you talk about the elevator fight? Have you
covered it? No, I'll talk about it. Oh, I'll talk about it
oh,
right
I'll
now.
Talk I'll talk about it all day.
I thought Jay-Z, regardless of whatever the fuck he said, that set her off, showed unbelievable restraint. Mm-hmm. Okay? Getting kicked by a woman in high heel shoes, I've been there. Okay? It fucking hurts. And he kept taking it to the hands. And there was a moment at one, I only watched it once. There was a time, like one of the last times she hit him, she even flinched. Because she was like, yeah, at this point, I deserve to get punched in the face. You see her flinch.
She spit at him. That was what was really awful.
That's what I forgot to do to that driver this morning. That would have been
spit
the,
at him?
The crowning
oh
bitch
God.
Move. No, I'd never do that.
No. But, you know, their family has problems like anybody else's family. I feel like, if anything, it just, you know, it just goes to show you that you shouldn't feel bad when, you know, your uncles or whatever start screaming at each other over Thanksgiving.
That is funny, though, when you really think about how many people who are judging them. Actually, there's footage that exists somewhere of their family fighting in an elevator. It's mm-hmm. just they're not famous and nobody
so
cares.
No one cares.
Yeah, so
exactly.
it just gets taped over.
Yeah. I feel like there are a lot more like physical fights that happen in families between siblings and stuff that most people wouldn't want to admit. You know, so I really don't think it's that big of a deal. I was watching it like, Solange, stop, no.
Well, he definitely said something fucked up because
he definitely
because
did.
Beyonce didn't do anything.
Yeah.
She was
and
standing
she left
there
with her sister too.
She was probably like, well, that's what happens when you say X, Y, and Z. That was her vibe.
yeah. So, but it's not that big of a deal. I don't feel like, you know.
No, that's kind of a big. No, that's a def. That's it's over. Their relationship is fucking over. And if money wasn't involved,
whose relationship?
Jay-Z's and the fucking
Solange's.
Yeah.
Nuh-uh.
Old sidekick there.
She's not a sidekick.
Yeah, she is. Come on. She's Frank Stallone.
No, she has a really good album out. I love her music, and she has great style. No, she's not as famous as Beyonce, obviously. And all these dumbass internet people on Twitter are like, I've never even heard of her until now. She should be thankful she got any kind
this
of
is,
press.
This is my
you don't know
my
shit
theory, Nene.
Just because you don't know music beyond what's on your top 40 radio station
hey,
that they play
hey.
In the morning while you're going to work doesn't mean that this person isn't talented. No, I just get annoyed with that.
Jeez, first the vegans, now the music lovers. This is the deal. The only way she can make it is if she's in the same group as Beyonce. Because that's the way it fucking works. There's no way, never in the history of two people in the same family trying to be a solo artist have they ever made it. They always, you got to be together. The Everly Brothers, the Jackson Five, the Osmonds. And then what happens is somebody breaks out of it. And then the rest of them go back to the dinner table going, I have an album out too. And everybody's like, yeah, we don't care. I know I'm your mother. I don't care. Michael is special. Donnie and Marie are the best. They're younger than you. They're cuter than you. And Jesus likes them better. And that's what happens. And you're fucked. So the only move she had was when Beyonce was on the way up. She should have been in Destiny's Child. Look at me.
She was.
Look at me on the other side of the fence
she
just calling
was.
Off groups here.
Bill, she was, well, maybe.
Was
she
in that group?
She was like a
I
backup.
I thought it was Kim
was
Coles and that chick from.
Kim
Coles? From the one on the roller skates, Tootie. Wasn't she in that?
You're just naming black people now.
Yeah.
No, she was like a backup dancer. She went on tour with them when she was younger. She had an album when she was younger.
Oh,
she
Jesus.
Got pregnant. She moved backup to dancer. Like
I was a
Oklahoma
backup
or something.
I was a backup dancer. I was. Remember that AC/DC? That AC/DC video, Who Made Who, when I had all the Anguses up there? I was one of the Anguses.
I wish I did. She also wrote quite a few of Beyonce's songs and like co-wrote some of Destiny Child's songs too. So, you know, she's got other talents
yeah.
and things, you know?
Yeah.
She doesn't need to be as famous
like
as her
that,
sister, though.
She's
but
like
she doesn't
that
need
chick.
To be.
And I say, hey, yeah, yeah.
Linda Perry?
Yeah. No.
Yes, that's
what's
who that
going
is.
On?
Her name is Linda Perry.
No, it isn't. No, it isn't.
She's the lead singer.
It isn't. It's
called,
like Jessica or something.
It's not. You know I'm right.
No, I don't know what her name is.
Four Non Blondes.
Yeah.
Lead singer Linda Perry, recently married to Sarah Gilbert from Roseanne. Did you know that? Who played Darlene? They're married. The last time I saw Linda Perry, not the last time, like I see her, but I saw her at
Wait,
the restaurant.
Wait, isn't that Four Non Blondes chick? Isn't she like, fuck, she's got to be my age.
Probably.
What's she going around with that little girl for?
What are you talking about? Sarah Gilbert's older than I am.
I saw the show the other day. She's like 12.
That's because she looks great.
No, but I was joking, watching the fucking TV show. I'm just bombing
you're
all over the place.
Nobody's holding the line. Some doubts just serve as a hypnotist. Up your mind. Save all sounds. Getting out a little too familiar now. Stop. We don't belong. Yeah. Stop. We don't belong. Yeah. Stop. We don't belong. Yeah.
Going on, it's Bill Burr, and it is the Monday Morning Podcast for Monday, July 27th, 2009, and the year of the cunt. I can never remember what year it is in the Chinese New. Is it the year of the pig? I think it is the year of the pig, isn't it? I saw a thing the other night where, you know, those shows where they have people, they flip houses. They buy some dilapidated hunk of shit from some old lady who just died when she fucking passed out face first in her fucking dog food because the goddamn bankers killed her 401k, right? Do old people have 401ks? Did they have that back in the day when they were buying war bonds? Look at my dog sleeping over there. Look at her. Fucking adorable. Yeah, I was watching this thing. You know, they flipped. I hate those shows where they flip the houses because you just see people getting completely fucked over. You get a couple of shitheads. They don't even know what they're doing. And then they go in there and they go to Grossman's or what's some awful hardware store? Home Depot. They go down there and they buy a bunch of cheap tiles. And then everybody walks in like, oh, my God, it's beautiful. Look at the tile work. And it was like done by this fucking accountant. You know, I hate to, you know, this old house, like it's, the guy gave a shit about the house. Now they're just showing people getting fucked over. I can't stand that when people walk in and then they think that the place looks amazing because they changed the brown paint to red and that opens the room up or whatever fucking mind trick they used. And it's still the exact same piece of shit house. And these guys sell it to these fucking morons for an extra 40 grand when all they had to do was buy a bucket of paint. You know what that reminds me of? I hate those commercials now where they're trying to make it seem like fast food is at the level of a 5-star restaurant. And they get these white trash fucking idiots and they just see a tablecloth and some cloth napkin and then they bring in some Pizza Hut and they're eating their pasta. Have you seen that commercial? And that girl's like, oh my God, it's so decadent. Who the fuck uses that word when they're talking about pasta? It's decadent, you know? It's like, did you just want to use that word, you dumb fuck? And then they come in, they're like, oh, it's Pizza Hut. It's Pizza Hut. Oh, my God, I can't believe it. I eat that shit every week.
It always tasted like shit, but now these fucking cloth napkins. Oh, my God. It's so fucking decadent.
Ugh. And they're breeding. And they're breeding. They're not using condoms. And they're eating pasta. I mean, how the... And I like how all these other fucking fast food places are acting like they invented these mini burgers. You know what I mean? Like White Castle doesn't exist. I'm really waiting for White Castle to sue... Jack in the Box, or any one of these other places. These guys who come up and they call them sliders, and evidently it's not as fattening, because rather than eating one burger, they take a burger and they cut it into three little ones. But because they're little, even though you're eating the exact same amount of fucking burger, you know, somehow it's less fattening. I don't know. I mean, so much what I just said is, you know, obviously just not even research. But, you know, that fucking lady using the word decadent just really annoys me. You know what annoys me even more? I can't even give you a fucking definition for it. What is it? Extravagant? Is that what it means? Or is that Latin for, oh my God, I can't believe this shitty pasta tastes much better with cloth napkins? Is that what the fuck it means? You know what? I'm going to look it up right now. I'm going to look it up right now because I'm going to set you guys up with what this week is going to be all about. This is going to be it's a lot of information. A lot of information this week that's going to be coming. How the fuck you spell decadent? D-E-C, deca, A, another A, deca, no, D-E-C-A, dent, deca, dent. Ah, Jesus Christ, that wasn't even close, was I? D-E-C-A-D-E-N-T. Wow, fuck, I got it. Holy shit. All right, decadence. Let's go to Wikipedia. God knows they're fucking credible. Decadence can refer to a personal trait or to the state of society or a segment of it. Used to describe a person's lifestyle. It describes... The fuck happened just there? My goddamn computer. Used to describe a person's lifestyle. It describes a lack of moral and intellectual discipline. Well, there's a fucking left turn. Oh, no, wait. Yeah, wait a second. No, that's... I guess it's got to be right, right? Am I going to question these people? I'm a moron. Bill, why don't you just read it and shut the fuck up? All right, I will. All right. Used to describe a person's lifestyle. It describes a lack of moral and intellectual discipline. Or in the... Oxford Dictionary, a luxurious self-indulgence. Okay, you know, who the fuck describes pasta as a luxurious self-indulgent? You know, some stupid white trash cunt who eats fucking macaroni and cheese 6 days a week, and all of a sudden you bring her a little fucking ziti, and, you know, she can't believe it. Oh my God, it's so decadent. She was actually, that was an insecure comment. They probably had an extra couple of forks there, and she started to panic. You know what I mean? Just like Jodie Foster, when she's talking to that dude in Silence of the Lambs, and he can tell that she grew up dirt poor because of her shoes, right? You know? That's all the end of that commercial needed, was somebody saying, I can smell your cunt. That would have been all right. You know, I'm really being crude right now, and I apologize, especially after last week, that video that I told all you guys to see. I got a lot of feedback about that one and about what a ignorant moron I am, and I'll be reading those a little bit later. Look at me foreshadowing here. You like that? Like I'm on a goddamn radio station. All right, let's get to some. If you're new to this podcast, I do one of these every week, and this is basically what it is. All right, if you think it's going to get better, like I'm building to something, I'm not. This is pretty much I'm going to flatline the whole week, and I feel like I have internal hiccups right now. You know those hiccups where you start to hiccup, but then you don't, huh? Am I doing an 80s bit again? What's the deal with internal hiccups? It's like a fart doesn't know where to go. Oh, God, I'd love to fucking do stand-up in the 80s. It was so much easier, wasn't it? One week you're an accountant, the next minute you're on Comic Strip Live, wearing the same blazer that you wore when you were doing somebody's taxes, except you just fucking pulled the sleeves up. And everything was funny back then. All right, let's get on to some shit here. Bill, just for your information, the guy, the rapper you were trying to talk about last week, it's pronounced, I still can't say, it's Kweli. I've never heard somebody say it. Talib Kweli. I don't fucking know what his name is. Quali. I mean, I listen to some of his rap. You know what I like about the guy? He doesn't say his fucking name every 3 seconds. And the one time when I need somebody to do it, he doesn't do it. I still don't know how to say it. This guy spelled it Q-U-A. How do you say it? Is that Qua? Quaze, right? That's how you say it. So Qua. Quali. Talib Quali. Yeah, this is fucking pathetic. What do I want to do? All right, you know? All right. Plowing ahead here. Here's one that somebody actually was going to have for another segment, but this seemed more like a Ask Bill. Here's two things I'd love to hear your opinion on, drugs and double dates. Yes, this guy wants to hear my opinions on double dates, and this actually, I think this is more of an Ask Bill kind of question. So he says, long story short, I met the hottest chick ever at a club. Dude, I met the hottest fucking chick ever. Her name's fucking Stacy. I get a number. I'm going to read this all like I'm a fucking Narcissus back in the day in Kenmore Square. Dude, let's go down to fucking Narcissus with our fucking Z Cavaricis, dude. We'll fucking go down there, get a couple of roofies, drop them in a fucking Zima, dude. Fucking cocksucker. All right, long story short, me and the hottest chick ever are at a club. I get her number. We talk. I ask her out. She changes it. Okay, I ask her out, and then she changes it to a double date with her sister. So I go out on this double date to an extremely expensive restaurant. I'm 22, in college, broke. I drop $140 on her. The sister wouldn't let me out of her sight, and all I got was one small kiss. Later on, I did not even get a kiss goodnight because the sister was watching. All right, dude. Now, you really shouldn't be asking my opinion on double dating. What this is really about is how did you, as a young man, 22, I'm going to cut you some slack here, end up in that situation, okay? Don't walk away from this just going like, you know, what you wanted to do, overrated, underrated, overrated, fucking, you know, double date and it sucks. No, you should have, right there, dude, you went, when she tried to turn it into a double date, right there, you just have to be, no, I don't want to do that. And she'll be like, why don't you want to do that? And you'll just be like, I don't like going on double dates. Why not? Because one person ends up not having a good time. And it's usually the other cunt that you bring. You can clean this up. This is no, you know what I mean. You just say it. I swear to God. That's, you know, when you're 22, you don't realize the power of no. All right? It actually seems like maybe you have some shit going on. Because at 22, most guys don't know how to talk to women. So all women hear is yes, 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 especially if they're hot. They just keep fucking agreeing with them. So if you say no, all of a sudden it's kind of different. I mean, you could fuck it up. But at the end of the day, dude, you didn't get laid and you were out $150. All right? Think about that moment when she said, let's turn, you know, going to turn this into a double date. What did your internal voice say? Oh, great. Or did it say, fuck, this is going to suck. This is going to suck. I'm not going to be able to get along with this girl. You know, Joe Pesci, I'm trying to fucking bang this broad over here. You know, it's not going to go good. So right there, you just got to say, no, I don't want to do a double date. And she'll say, why? And just say, because I'm 22. What am I, Potsy? We on happy days? We going to go to Inspiration Point? You want to go out on a date with me or don't you? At that point, you bring a little anger into it, and you kind of just show the side of your head, and you don't really look at her. That'll get you. That'll get you a second date. All right, that was fucking brutal. That was bad advice. I'm trying to tell you, dude, just don't fucking go on a double date, all right? They suck. You knew they suck. You knew before you even went on it. You knew it was going to suck. And if you're broke, don't take a girl to someplace where you got to drop $140. You know? What did she do to deserve $140 meal? What, because she's hot? Like that's some sort of accomplishment? She was born that way. You know? What you did is you basically took probably a nice girl and you just added another layer to the foundation of her just being an incredibly stuck-up human being who doesn't have to develop a personality. You know? Look at me making all these judgments. But I think it's true. Just because you're hot doesn't mean you deserve a $140 meal. If you're broke, dude, be honest with yourself. If that chick was like a 7, you know, you'd probably take it a Pizza Hut for some fucking decadent pasta. So, I don't know. Did I help you there? I got to stop doing these podcasts on Sunday because I'm fucking jet lagged from flying back to wherever the fuck I came from. I was actually working Denver this weekend. I was at the Comedy Works, so I should take some time here to thank everyone who came out to see me. The turnout in Denver was ridiculous, and I actually flew in a day early, and I got to do 5 minutes out at Red Rocks. And if you're not from Denver and you're not a fan of U2, just go on YouTube and just Google Red Rocks. It's fucking it's one of the most amazing venues. It's basically an outdoor venue built into the side of a mountain. And that YouTube video, speaking of that, yeah, that's what I was trying to say. That YouTube video, I don't know what the fuck it was called. Unforgettable Fire. I don't know what was it about. What was it about? What does YouTube sing about? They sing about breaking up with girls, Martin Luther King, and then they went through their irony stage, didn't they? Where he wore the big glasses, and he just acted like everything was fucking surreal. I don't know, whatever. There's a video that they did way back in the day, and he marches around like with a fucking flag, like he's in I don't know, like they're doing something. He's playing like this military beat, and he comes oh, it's like an old fucking David Spade bit. He starts chanting "No War." There you go. It's that video. Yeah, no, Bill, we got it. It's not like they're a small fucking indie band. We knew 10 minutes ago when you started describing it. All right, all right. Sometimes I get a little carried away. Just reminds me of something. I had a falling out with somebody like 2 months ago. You ever have somebody, a friend of yours, just say something so fucking stupid that you don't even get angry? And you just have that moment like, wow, I can't be friends with this person anymore because they're a fucking moron. You know? You know what happened? Somebody, it's happened to me twice. One time somebody said, they were talking about Secretariat, that horse. And they were talking about all the races the horse won. And in the end, they went, what an athlete. And I don't know, that was it. I just could never look at him the same way. What an athlete. You know, I just... Do I even need to fucking go off on that? Do I need to explain? Can you tell I'm actually scrolling down? I'm trying to find something else. Somebody wrote a fucking question about that. This whole fucking podcast is just falling apart. This is what you get. You know what? Maybe if I started charging for these things, I'd take them a little more seriously, and we wouldn't have these long lulls. My dog's fast asleep from my monotone voice. There's no passion in this. What am I doing here? Where the fuck is it? You know what? Fuck this podcast. Am I going to start over? I'm not going to start. You know, I'm going to plow through. I can't start over. This is it. I got one take. This is like live television here. I'm just going to read everything in front of me. How about that? All right. Bill, I was listening to your podcast on July 20th. You said that the YouTube video, Tough Talking College Girl, was a must-see. I searched for it. Oh, yeah. The people kind of took it down. People took that one down. And if you didn't see it, that's people keep putting it back up. So just check every couple of days. Just look up, search Tough Talking College Girl, T-U-F-F, and it's talking with a G, even though I don't pronounce my G's. Anyways, here's one for you. P.S. My girlfriend and I were at the grocery store last night, and all that they had open were those self-checkouts. This was the first time I was put in that situation because they usually always have at least one real lane open. Anyways, the place was fucking swamped. And going to a real person to pay for the shit wasn't even an option. There were three fucking employees. It was just three fucking employees standing there. I went up to the three fucks and I asked them if they would open a real lane. And they just told me that they were too short-staffed. Fucking horseshit, this guy says. He said, I thought to myself, where is Bill Burr when you need him? Dude, what would I do other than just sit there and curse under my breath next to some fucking candy like you did? Fucking bullshit. It's fucking bullshit. So I got in line and I rang up my own shit like a little bitch. I had no other option. What would you have done in that situation? I would have done exactly what you did. I would have been hostile towards the three people there. I would have cursed under my breath. And then I probably just would have fucking... You know, depending on how much I needed the shit, if I really didn't need the stuff, what I would have done, what I'd like to, you know what I'm doing right now? I'm doing that shit, you know, where after something goes down and the guy tells you the story, then there's always that douchebag who goes, dude, you know what I would have done? You know what I would have done now that I have all the fucking information? You know what you could do in the future is just say, oh, well, then I'm going to come back during the day when you have some people, and then just leave your food there. And let them put it back. You know? Dude, I told you this was going to fucking happen. They're understaffed. They're understaffed on purpose. That's phase two. Phase one was just to have like five or six fucking registers and give you three others. So all the fucking sheep look over the curiosity factor, what's going on. And then you had the other cashiers over there teaching them how to fucking use it. Now they've gotten beyond that. Now they're going into phase two. Okay, phase two of the experiment. What happens if there's no, if there are no cashier people? How will the herd handle this? When should we do it? Well, we can't do it during the day. There's fucking old people in their little motor cars riding around. Let's do it later on at night. Let's see how the drunk crowd handles it. Even if they don't like it, they won't fucking remember. At the very least, they won't send any angry letters. I'm telling you, this is how the whole fucking thing's going to go. And somebody actually asked me in this this week, asked me, they were curious as to what I thought about ATMs. Yeah, I'm not against technology. Is if it makes my life, like, easier. Like, ATMs at banks, before, I don't know if you guys remember this shit, but back in the day when there was no ATMs, you know, Friday, 5 o'clock, if you didn't grab the cash you needed for the weekend, you were fucked. You couldn't get to your money. Oh, actually, they would be open for, like, 20 minutes on a Saturday. But, yeah, that would just be that expression. The guy's working banker hours. He used to be open, like, 9 to 5. You can never even get your fucking money out. So what I like about the ATM is at least I have access to my money. I don't mind that. And a lot of times it is easier to just throw it in there. So I don't give a fuck. You know? That one doesn't bug me. And I understand that technology does replace some jobs. The reason why I can't stand this latest brand of automated shit is it's not an advancement. It doesn't make it easier. I just go up and do exactly what the cashier did and the bag person did, except I'm doing it for free. Now, if I walked up to the cashier machine, the automated thing, and magically the fucking thing figured out what I owed and suddenly it was all in a bag, I wouldn't give a shit. All right? I don't know. People just hear what they want to hear. Like, you make one comment about something. This guy doesn't like technology. He's against penicillin. No, I'm not. I'm not against advancements. I'm against fuckovers. And those automated things in the grocery store and at the parking garage, the automated park are fuckovers. It doesn't make it quicker. It actually makes it longer in a lot of instances. And I'm just working for free. I'm working for free. And I don't fucking like it, okay? And that's the last time I'm fucking explaining it. And I don't need any of you douchebags going, oh, I rang up my oranges the other day and it was quicker. You're a moron. Just fucking work for free. All right, here we go. What are we going on to? Somebody sent me an email, said, hey, Bill, just want to thank you. Thanks a bunch for teaching me about tinnitus. That's that ringing in the ear stuff I was talking about. I just turned 21. I had that shit as long as I can remember. Didn't know what it was. Thought it was just me. For anyone that has the problem and not sure what to do, when I was younger, I left the TV on. That was a bad idea. After that, I played mostly chill music. In my music collection, and a 70-minute album or something like that. Now I just sort of put a fan on low speed, and it keeps the ringing away. For those of you who don't have tinnitus, what he's saying is you put some sort of quieter noise in the background that drowns out the ringing in your ear. And actually, do what you really should do is go see a doctor, is what you're supposed to do. And I don't know. I think the cases of tinnitus is going to go way up just because of, like, iPods. And when you go to clubs, how loud they play that fucking music. Actually, you know, I actually bring earplugs everywhere I go because I have such fucked up ears. At least I try to remember. But basically how it works is anything up to about 60 or 65 decibels, you're pretty much cool. And you can listen. Your ear can handle, like, right around 60 decibels. That's like how I'm talking right now, regular conversation, and you don't do any damage to your ears. Your ears can listen to it for, you know, all day, and you don't do any damage. But what happens, I forget how the math works, but every time you move up 10 decibels, like 60 to 70, the time frame that your ears can listen to that level of noise without doing permanent damage goes down really quickly. And I know somewhere, right when you start getting around 80, that starts getting dangerous. And anything above 90, I mean, I think like 90, listening to something at 90 minutes, don't quote me on this. I forget. I used to have this chart and all this shit. I tried to find it on the internet, but I couldn't. But anything around 90 decibels after like 15 minutes, and you can easily with an iPod go up to about 110. 15 minutes of listening to music, you do permanent damage to your hearing. And I know that sounds fucked up. It's just incremental and you can't tell. I forget. I read all this shit. There's little hairs in there. And when you blow it out, the things get knocked down. And then they slowly stand back up again. And after a while, they just don't get back up again. They just fucking like a boxer. They just lay in there. And you go into clubs, man. And they have those that fucking music up to like $1.15, $1.20. If you notice, the bouncers who work there always have earplugs for the most part. I don't know. I suffer from tinnitus. You don't want it. It's horrific, but if you have it, you should definitely go see a doctor. And I would always have earplugs on you just in case, you know, you're hanging out. Hey, let's check out this bar. And you go in there. And I don't know why they play the music that fucking loud. I can tell if there's a DJ and there's dancer. But when you just walk into a bar and you're having a couple beers and you got to scream, I can't fucking stand that. I don't know. Maybe because I'm old. Who knows? All right, let's move on to the next section here. I'm just reading shit this week. All right, I don't know why I forget what this is, but this section is named The Accidental Racist. All right, hey Bill, I just downloaded a bunch of your uninformed shows on Mini Nova and just began listening to the first one, a show from February 10th, 2007. I stopped at 3 minutes in to write you to thank you for delivering already. The accidental racism to the Asian guy. Oh, that's why this name is. In the elevator story. It kind of reminded me of a semi-funny thing that happened to me. All right, just to get you guys caught up. I was going up in the elevator at the old XM building. Evidently on February 10th, 2007. And it was me and Joe DeRosa who do the show. And there was this Asian guy in the elevator. And I can't remember what, but he seemed confused. And he was, somehow I didn't know what floor he was on. Somehow I made the assumption that he was delivering food. And I conveyed that to him. And I was, said something like, oh, what are you delivering food? And he just put his head down and he goes, I work here. And I felt like such a fucking asshole. But he looked disheveled. And he was dressed down. We did the show on a Saturday, so he wasn't dressed like he was going to work. It was just one of those things. If I could find the guy, I would apologize to him. But you know what I mean? There are a lot of Asian guys delivering food in New York, you know? So, and they're always going up elevators, and they always have that look of like, what fucking floor am I going to? I don't know. The guy, I don't know. I don't know what happened. Maybe he got an argument with his girlfriend. It's how I read it. So anyways, I felt like an asshole and I apologize if for some reason he's listening to this podcast. It'd be funny if he actually was a listener of my podcast and didn't realize that was me and now realizes it's me and now I've lost another listener. Anyway, so this guy, I guess, has a story just like it. So when he says, anyways, my junior year in college, I was looking for a roommate because some previous people I had lined up dropped out on me in the last minute. A girl I was friends with put me in touch with the guy she was friends with because he was looking for a place too. Despite both of us having this girl as a mutual friend, we never met each other. We set everything up over the phone and came to terms we could both live with without ever even meeting in person. Thus, the first time we would meet was at the place we would both be living in. Jesus, dude, you're really taking a risk there. There are some things about me that are vital pieces of information in order for this story to make sense. First of all, I'm black. However, due to the tone and the pitch of my voice, my usage of correct grammar most of the time, you know, dude, if I said that, I would really be in trouble, but you can trash your own people. Okay, so everything's good. He said, I was an English major, but I'm not an asshole about it, I promise. Correct grammar, I use correct grammar most of the time, and the semi-racist nature of most people, many people have told me that I sound white or could be mistaken for a white person over the phone. I'm going to address that point a little bit later. All right. So getting back to the story, when I talked to this kid over the phone, we found out we had both gone to the same high school for a year. Again, despite that, we didn't know each other. The fact that this school was mostly white, combined with the sounds of his voice, I thought he was white, in my mind, which set up this awesome situation. I figured he was guessing I was white for the same reason I was guessing he was. I was really looking forward to seeing this white kid squirm when he pulled up and realized I was black. Of course, a black kid pulled up to the house looking for me, and it was my prospective roommate. I remember seeing a little bit of surprise look on his face, and I said to him, "You thought I was white, didn't you?" And then, of course, my computer craps out. He smiled and admitted he did. I told him that I thought he was white as well. We both ended up having a great laugh about it and became pretty good friends afterwards. Anyways, thanks for the podcast. Okay, let me get back to that. The semi-racist nature of most people, many people have told me that I sound white or could be mistaken for a white person over the phone. For the life of me, I don't know why that is considered racist. Okay? I don't know if you've noticed, but like white people kind of talk in a certain way. I mean, if you watch Def Jam, we just talk in one way. But like, you know, there is... You know, if I was on here and all of a sudden I was like, yo, you know what I'm saying? Doing motherfucking podcasts and shit. You'd be like, why is Bill trying to talk like he's some black dude from the ghetto? Wouldn't you? Would that be racist? Or, you know, there's nothing wrong with... What the fuck am I trying to say here? If you just say somebody sounds white, you're not saying they're a moron, right? Am I a fucking idiot here? I don't understand why I'm saying, you know, over the phone, yeah, you sounded like a black guy. Or, hey, you sounded white over the phone. Does it go back to that correct grammar thing? That the black person then assumes like, oh, what, because I didn't say motherfucker every 5 seconds? I know I do a brutal fucking impression. but is that why it is? That's actually an interesting question. See, isn't this a great fucking podcast? Through my stupidity, you guys learn shit. Unless you already know it and you're rolling your fucking eyes. At that place, if that's the case, go fuck yourself. All right. And then this guy also ends this email. He says, what did he say here? Anyways, thanks for the podcast. They're awesome. And as a New York Yankees fan, I want to thank the Red Sox for keeping first place warm for us. Good luck with David. I can't hit anymore now that steroids are banned. Ortiz and Jason, we had to trade one of the best right-handed hitters of all time for this non-threatening white guy. Bay for the rest of the summer. You know, you got a lot of balls as a Yankee fan bringing up steroids. Okay? Half your fucking team got busted. Do I really need to go through the names? A-Rod, Sheffield, Giambi, Clemens, Pettit. You're a fucking $200 million team and you're on steroids. Okay? At least our steroided guys are fucking winning championships, you bunch of cunts. No, I'm sorry. You won it 99 and 2000 with your steroid guys. You know? I love how Yankee fans are talking. You got a $200 million team. You're barely playing 600 baseball. You know? That's like having a fucking Lamborghini and you're psyched it's going 70 miles an hour. You guys should be playing like 720 ball. With all those fucking guys you have. And you know what the funny thing is? You still don't have a bullpen, so you're not going to win shit this year. It's a joke. You know what, you guys? You're like a super group. You know, why don't you just sign fucking Ted Nugent to play center field? You know, hey, we're just the $122 million team that could. That's the best thing about Manny Ramirez going out to L.A., is that it knocked our payroll way the fuck down. Now we're down to like $122 million. We're actually number four this year, people. We're behind the Yankees, the Mets, and who's it, the Cubs or the Dodgers? I can't, not the Dodgers. Who the fuck was it? Maybe the Cubs. I don't know who it is. All I know is we're number four. We're like $80 million less, and this guy's all excited because they're 2-3 games ahead of us. Even though you're 0-8 against the Red Sox, and you got swept by the Angels. Huh, what are y'all excited because you're feasting on the Royals and the Rangers and all that shit? And Jason Bay is a great fucking baseball player. And he's been doing a great job for us, and we've barely missed Manny. I hate to say it. I love the guy. And just for the record, he didn't do steroids till he got to L.A., you know? Dude, when did he get caught? He didn't get caught when he was in Boston that whole fucking time. All of a sudden, he comes out to L.A. He starts running with the wrong crowd, you know? Happens to the best of them when they come out here. Look at River Phoenix. He came out here. He did some roids. He fucking never got up again. Cute little actor he was. All right, here we go. Here's another thing. I don't know why I'm reading this, but I'm just going to read it. Dude, I can't believe you didn't notice that she... Okay, wait a minute. Wait. Okay, here we go. Wait a minute. All right, what am I doing here? All right, this is the response, one of the responses I got from that leg sweep video last week. And if you're new to my podcast, there's a video up on YouTube. I guess it got taken down where this guy hits on this girl. She doesn't, you know, she's not having it. So he gives her shit. She gives him the finger. He calls her a bitch. She throws a drink in his face. And he goes up. You think he's going to blast her in the face. And he just gives her a fucking leg sweep that it should have been done in Mandalay Bay in Las Vegas. It was fucking tremendous. All right, here we go. So this woman wrote me. She goes, Bill, I can't believe you didn't notice that she was visited with violent behavior first. This is the girl in the video. Because I was sitting there saying I thought the video was funny because the girl threw the drink in his face. And even though you should never hit a woman, I just think that's outrageous in life to think that you can throw a drink in somebody's face. I just know if I did it, within 2 seconds, I would be on the ground getting fucking pummeled. And I don't know. There was just something funny about it. So anyway, she goes, I can't believe you didn't notice that she was visited with violent behavior first. Watch it again, and you'll see him violently poke at her. All right, first of all, how fucking hilarious is that? Violently, have you ever heard that expression in your life? Violently poked? There's no such thing as being violently poked, all right? It's called stab. That's, you know, that's violent. Actually, my gym teacher used to violently poke me in the chest, fucking cocksucker. He didn't. He gave her a little fucking poke. He did it one time to her fucking shoulder. That was it. He was just trying to annoy her. But anyway, she says, by the way, it's not very complimentary to a grown woman to be shown that he has a crush on her by punching her. He didn't punch her. Anyway, she goes, I can't believe you're not allowing her to do the only thing she can, toss a drink at him, since she can't beat him up. Do you honestly believe that her throwing the drink equals his kick / knock to her on the skull? Shame on you, you bastard. So I wrote her back. I said, I knew this would spark some debate. I respect your point of view on it, so here's mine. Violently poked. 41 years on this planet, and I have never heard someone being violently poked. She threw the drink in his face because he called her a bitch. Then she goes, that's right, I am a bitch, and then the drink is thrown. And throwing the drink in his face was not the only thing she could have done. She could have walked away. She could have talked to whoever was in charge at the pool. She could have talked to some of the guys who were over there by her friends. There were a bunch of things she could have done, but she lost her cool. And if you're going to define the action by the guy in the video as violently poking her, then you could also address, couldn't you also address the racial undertones of her giving the man the finger and stating, do you understand this in English? The reason why the video is so funny is because the unexpected happened. He actually treated her the same way he would have treated a man that threw a drink in his face. So the reason men find the video funny, I think, is because the amount of times women get physical with us and there's nothing we can do except get punched, slap, or have a drink thrown in our face because we're never going to hit a woman and they know it. I had a girl try to punch me in the face in a bar, and as I'm trying as carefully as possible to defend against getting punched in the face, basically I'm turning my back and covering up as this girl wailed away, the bouncer comes flying over, and what do you think? Who do you think they grabbed and tossed out? I was in an argument with the female, but so what? People argue. But because of the way things are, she can take it to a physical level while I have to try and defend myself without getting physical with her at all, only to be dragged out by the neck. You know, if they tossed her out too, I would have been fine with it. But because she's a female, she gets to throw punches, have me kicked out, and she gets to stay in the bar while they continue to serve her more drinks. So to go back to the video, That is the world this woman is living in. I'm a girl. I can do this and nothing will happen. I can throw a full drink in someone's face and nothing will happen. Well, guess what? Something did. The exact thing, same thing that would have happened to me. And then I go on to say, actually, I would have been fucking punched repeatedly in the face. And the dude's friends probably would have jumped in too. And you know what the reaction from the other people at the pool would have been? Well, you threw a drink at his face. What did you think was going to happen? And then I guess my excuse would have been, but he poked me violently. Anyways, I've never hit a woman and I don't advocate it. That guy in the video is an animal and I wouldn't want any woman I cared about to ever date him. But the leg sweep, the fucking leg sweep was genius and undeniably funny to me. I'm just going to read you all these back and forth. So then she goes, you have no idea what women have to put up with. All right, this is where I guess I'm a moron. These guys take such personal offense when they're turned down. He should have walked away. I will not tolerate being touched by a stranger in that way, and it is a really vulnerable feeling as a woman and makes us angry and fearful of men. Besides, you didn't hear the things he was saying. Guys like that, parentheses, in hip-hop style clothing, are the sleaziest of scumbags, licking their lips, nasty. Who's hitting on you, LL Cool J? Why don't you fucking go to a nicer place? Anyways, as for the argument you had in the bar, you didn't specify. Now she's talking to me. This is classic line here. She goes, as for the argument you had with that woman in the bar, you didn't specify what it was about, what it was about, and if you were yelling in her face, as you know you probably were, ... more violent behavior. You see that? Let's stop right here. This is what I love about this type of shit. Anytime there's a group of people bitching about their situation, 9 times out of 10, when they're bitching, they end up doing the exact same thing to the person that they're bitching at that they don't want done to them. Look how you assume that immediately, I'm getting hit. I'm not hitting her back. I'm getting hit, and you're blaming me. I'm surprised you didn't ask me what I was wearing. Was I asking for it? Anyways, you want to hear the story, sweetheart? This is basically, this is why this girl was punching me in the bar. All right. We're going back here about 10 years. I'm standing up now. I'm going to tell this story. My dog's looking at me. What's up, Cleo? How you doing, huh? You're a female, huh? You can defend yourself, you fucking psycho. This is what happened. I was in a bar, and I was with some buddies of mine. This group of girls is next to us. We're hitting on them, you know? We're making jokes. We're joking around. You know, you try to get women to laugh. That's what the fuck you have to do. Women, I know you don't understand that because you don't have to make somebody want to fuck you, okay? The same way I don't know what it's like to have to carry a fucking living thing inside of me for 9 months. I understand. We all have our advantages. So whatever. I'm not trying to be a douche here, but this is basically it. So we're trying to, you know, we're joking around or whatever. I had a couple drinks. They had a couple drinks. And one of them was dressed like she looked like Rhoda on Mary Tyler Moore, right? So at one point, that girl goes up, and she goes to go to the bathroom. So I say to her friend, I go, Jesus Christ, was she a big fan of Mary Tyler Moore or what, right? Made a joke about what she was wearing. So another 20 minutes goes by. Those girls kind of peeled off. You know, we weren't really talking to them anymore. We were, or maybe we kind of were. I don't know what was going on. Sort of that type of shit. You're talking to a girl for a couple seconds, then it's not working out. So I went back. I was talking to my friend, and I guessed when the girl came back from the bathroom, her friend told her what I said. So unbeknownst to me. So I'm sitting there talking to my buddy. Then all of a sudden I just hear this woman yelling, hey, bitch. Hey, bitch. Right? So I look over and she's looking at me. She's going, hey, bitch. And I'm trying to process because I, you know, typical me, I said some shit. I didn't even remember what the fuck I said. And then she goes, you know, you're going to talk shit about me when I'm not around? And then I kind of was, right as I'm putting it together, then she stood up and she fucking put her hand over. You ever see like a center in the NBA, how they fight, how they can't throw, they fucking throw punches like that they're trying to fucking throw somebody out at second base? That's what she did. She winds up and she's about ready to come down on the top of my head. So, you know, because she wound up, I mean, if she fucking threw a jab, she would have fucking blasted me right in the face. And I got to admit, that would have been fucking hilarious. But because she went up and over, I was able to get my arm up in time. And I sort of like caught her wrist. So now instantly I recognize the situation. I'm like, oh, fuck. Okay, this girl is not going to stop, and I don't want to get hit in the face. I can't squeeze her wrist too hard. All this shit's going through my head, and I know, even though I can't see it, I know the bouncers are on their way over, and I know what the fuck's going to happen. So all I'm doing is holding her wrist as she's fucking clawing at my side. I'm sort of turned to the side, and of course, my buddies aren't doing anything. They're sort of just looking at this point because it happened so fast, and I'm going, whoa, whoa, whoa. I was going, hey, hey, hey. I can't even remember what I was saying. I was just... Just too much shit was going on. I couldn't formulate anything to say to get this girl to stop, but she just kept fucking, bitch, you fucking bitch. It was like punching me in the side. And then the fucking bouncers come over and they fucking grab me, of course, because I'm the guy. I just blew my mind. I almost have my back turned to this girl with my hand up and she's wailing away and they immediately go to me and I get fucking tossed out. You know, so let me ask you this. In her world, was she justified for taking it to a physical level because I fucking made fun of her outfit? You know, that's was my point about that video. I don't think that you should hit a woman. The reality of that video that I watched there on YouTube is that they're both assholes and they're both stubborn. And what happened there is what you saw when you get two stubborn people who want to get the last word in. Okay, he hits on her. She tells him to go fuck himself. Not saying she literally said that, but she basically says no. So he couldn't handle it. So he starts it. I'll give you that. He starts it, okay? And he wants to get the last word in. So she can't let him, right? He should have walked away, but he didn't. That's, you know, right in the beginning, he didn't. So he gives her shit. Then she should have walked away, realized he was a psycho. She doesn't. She fucking gives him the finger. Then he should have walked away, but he doesn't. He pokes her. She should have walked away then, but she doesn't. She fucking throws a drink at his face. He should have fucking walked away. He doesn't. He fucking goes up and he leg sweeps her. It's just one of those deals. Two fucking assholes who probably should be breeding and make a little fucking asshole kid, and then we'll have another Dog the Bounty Hunter. Huh? You see how that math works out? So anyways, I don't know. Sometimes I feel like I'm saying shit and people don't get what the fuck I'm talking about. I'm not saying that you should go around hitting a woman. I'm just saying... You know, guys should never hit women, but women shouldn't take advantage of that by doing outrageous shit like throwing a drink in somebody's face. That is fucking outrageous behavior. And be honest, as a female, if another female walked up to you and threw a drink in your face, what would you do? Huh? What would you do? Would you just go, oh, that was mature? Do you feel better about yourself? Is Sprite is dripping down the fucking, your bangs, whatever fucking... You got that Rachel Bob haircut from Friends. Huh? Look at me. Look at me with that fucking chick reference. Whatever. Oh, who gives a fuck anyways? All right, here's some videos. So I nominated that video for Video of the Year. And so people sent me some other videos. And I'm really upset at myself because somebody sent me a great video of these two bullies attacking this guy with his girlfriend. And the guy's girlfriend jumps in and she fucking blasts this guy in the face in the end. It's a fucking awesome video. So I really need that video so I can balance it out. So I don't just have videos of guys knocking women down because that's not what I'm trying to do here. You know what I mean? This is supposed to be a fun thing for everybody. And all right, so here you go. Here's some nominees. Somebody, ONA fan said Ace Frehley was on the show this week celebrating Jim Norton's birthday. And he recommended a video called Winnebago Man. I watched it. It's fucking hilarious. Google how to spell Winnebago. I'm just going to tell you what the name of the videos are. There's another one, Guy with Gun Confronts Skateboarder. And there's another one that says, this is the last one. And I deliberately put this one last because this is more in the vein of last week's video. It says, Guy Gets Revenge on Girlfriend for Headache. This one's really more silly, and I'm actually jealous of, like, how perfectly this guy's prank works out. It's just, it really is a work of art, and most females won't like it, but it's, you know, no one gets hurt in this one, okay? Nobody's head hits concrete. Yeah, that's it, okay? And if you're sick of those kinds of videos, there's one on there of a little fucking golden retriever puppy howling, all right? Go Google that one, okay? That'll make you fucking smile. All right. I'm going to have to wind this. Jesus Christ, 47 fucking minutes. All right, let me wind this up real quick. We're talking about grenades again, people. The subject that just won't die. Bill, I missed the last couple of podcasts. This is from a Marine, so we can all hang out here, right? 47 minutes in. Let's support the troops and listen to the last few minutes of the podcast here. I missed the last few podcasts, but there was a lot about the military. You seem to be interested in the military. I was a Marine for 4 years and did my tour in the sandbox, parentheses, Iraq. Go on Wikipedia and type in Operation Phantom Fury. Those are my credentials. That kid you talked about on 629 was kind of a joke. I can tell by what he says. So he's basically saying the other military person who gave me my grenade information is, I guess working in a mess hall. Look at me trying to start some shit. Look at me, huh? Hey, guy from June 29th, you going to take that shit? He's saying you don't know about grenades. So anyways, he says frag grenades have a kill radius of 5 meters. Casualty is 15 meters. Casualty, I guess that's shrapnel. Okay. Marines definitely use frags when necessary. They use flashbangs when doing raids. If you're using a flashbang and entering a room and you shoot blindly everywhere, it's a total contradiction to what you're doing in the first place, trying not to kill everyone in the room. If there's bad guys in there, you frag the fucks. I guess that you throw the grenade in there. And if you throw in one, you might as well throw in five. Grenades aren't that lethal. Well, they are, but it just kind of depends. Two guys in another company toss grenades into a house from different directions, only to have the grenades roll across the house, cross paths, and in front of the other Marine, respectively. Jesus Christ, I think I saw this on the Three Stooges. They both dove away and only received minor shrapnel to the legs. More of something to laugh about more than anything. All right, so there's your grenade information. Here we go with earplugs, getting back to the tinnitus shit. When in some nasty shit, basically when you're in battle, you have one earplug in and one out. Due to the sound resistance created by plugs, it only allows you to hear a certain range of noise. Take one out and it allows you to hear the larger range of noise even after you can barely hear out of one ear. Dude, that's fucking insane. That's what I did, and it always worked. So basically, you sacrifice one ear. Did you switch off every other battle, or did you just say, fuck my left ear? I guess you need to do that, because what if you have the earplugs in and somebody's sneaking up behind you? Good God. Thank God. Thank God I didn't have to do that. God bless you. Anyways, a machine gun next to an unprotected ear isn't that bad at all. Loud as explosions. Loud as airstrikes, loud as rockets, loud as standing next to a tank in an alley and not having any earplugs. The concussion reverberates and ricochets along the walls of the buildings. I know because it happened to me and my ears started to leak clear fluid, presumably from perforated eardrums. The sound was beyond sound. That's one of the greatest sentences I've ever read as far as, like, fucking description. The sound was beyond sound. It was an impact. It felt like I was hit with a 2x4 across my entire body all at once. My face and my balls hurt. Jesus Christ. That's from sound, I guess. I don't fucking know. Just shut up and read it, Bill. All right. I had my wind knocked out. Basically, I was almost even with the barrel of the main tank gun, and the fucking guys in the tank never gave us a signal that they were going to shoot. That's what a concussion blast feels like, and it gets worse the closer you get and the bigger the explosion is. Throw in some shrapnel and you get the idea. Jesus Christ, dude, this is better than the fucking History Channel. I'm really enjoying this. All right, and you talked about the stress of battle. There was one dude who was about to get out of an AAV, big armored vehicle, and he went blind. I guess he's saying from the stress. And then he writes, just went blind. He regained his sight a few days later, but right before he got out, he literally had to turn around and say, I can't fucking see. Jesus Christ. As for a funny story, oh, you know what that reminds me of? You guys seen that movie. What the fuck was it? I was going to tell you to watch that last week. It was an animated movie about war. The fuck was it called? I just rented it. Waltz with Brashear. You guys see that? I highly recommend that. That's about a guy who went to war, and when he came back, he couldn't fucking remember anything. So then he goes around and he talks to his former army buddies. You know, that's the whole hook. A guy who can't remember goes around and talks to those who can't forget. It's pretty fucking amazing. So anyways, let me continue here. And as far as for a funny story, in war, the stories are all fucked up. It's all fucked up humor when you're over there. Like really sadistic, fucked up shit. Even the nicest evangelistic person or a Mormon will have the same humor over there. Personally, I found it hilarious when insurgents were so drugged up, they would literally step out of an alley in front of a tank about 50 feet away and just start shooting an AK-47 at the thing. The machine gun on the tank would slowly point towards the dude and just shred him. That's funny when you're over there. Wow. This is like Time Life Books presents the Iraq War as it's going on. So let me ask you this. You're saying the dude's so, like, hopped up on drugs? Like, are a lot of the insurgents over there on drugs? And why are they on drugs? Because they're scared from the stress of the battle? I mean, I can't imagine that. Anyways, probably the best story that normal people can relate to was when we first took over a centrally located compound within the city of Fallujah, referred to above as Operation Phantom Fury. Dude, you were in Fallujah? Holy shit. All right, this is a great story, by the way, so hang in there, guys. I know this is long. This was the third day of the assault on the city. Obviously, after 3 days, a bunch of dudes are going to have to take a shit at some point, so we had to dig some trenches. The trenches were in the middle of a large courtyard about the size of a football field, and instead of just standing over the trench like a dog and squatting to shit, we knew we had to find something to assist us when we dropped guts. Good Lord. Okay, I mean, fuck it. If we're going to get popped while taking a shit, we better be comfortable. We started searching around, and inside some of the side buildings, we found some chairs and some wooden boxes. We cut holes in them and positioned them over the trenches. The area wasn't what the military would deem as, would not consider secure at the time. But after eating the instant dehydrated shit meals called MREs, which constipate you, you having constant operations for 3 days, we hadn't had a satisfying shit for 3 days. After the new shitters were set up, guys were a little apprehensive to go out there, as there were still RPGs, mortars, and gunfires directed towards our compound. You have to understand that Marines and the Marine Corps... All right, this is him saying this shit, not me. You have to understand that the Marines and the Marine Corps alike are retarded. Many individuals are very intelligent within the Marines, but the Marine Corps just makes you into a retard, and therefore the policies within the Marine Corps are retarded as well. The only thing the Marine Corps doesn't fuck up is combat. This retardation is why most people reenlist less with the Marine Corps than any other branch. Well, you have to expand on that. So anyway, so being the retarded Marines we were, we said, fuck it. A bunch of us strolled out and took off our Kevlars, our helmets, and flax bulletproof vests, as well as our blouses, shirts. Within 2 minutes... there were 10 or 12 Marines sitting in the middle of this field, bare as bones, courtyard the size of a football field with only T-shirts and trousers at the ankles, smoking butts, chewing dip, joking around like we were at a fucking Applebee's while there were explosions and gunfire going off 150 meters away. Jesus Christ, was Robert Duvall fucking surfing in the background? Actually, he didn't surf. He was on the beach. Anyways, as we were sitting there, a few civilian reporters poked their heads out of the compound and went back in. They were looking to see in the proverbial coast, to see if the proverbial coast was clear to the armored vehicle they were using for transport. So basically, there was a bunch of reporters poking their heads out, trying to get over to their fucking armored transport. Mind you, this was the typical type of vehicle with the type of armor that our unit couldn't get at the time, because ours kept getting fucked up, and it was too much of a monetary drain to give us the proper protection, because our vehicles will get blown up every couple of weeks. Sorry, I'm paraphrasing because this is really fucking long. These people had no business being there, and they knew it. This was evidenced by the fact that they continued to poke their heads out of doorways several more times. Apparently, they got their courage up because all at once, the group of about 10 people who looked like my 7th grade gym class started making their way to the armored vehicle in their gay little blue helmets and vests that read "Press" in big, bold white letters. They were visibly nervous, jogging mechanically and looking spastically in every direction as if they would somehow be able to change their fate if an insurgent decided to lean out a window and open fire at them. As they jogged along, we sat there half-naked from the bottom down and stared at them in utter amusement. After a few seconds of silence, someone shitting next to me screamed, "Incoming!" It was like a kick to the fucking nuts. Something snapped. The reporters absolutely lost their shit. It was one of the most beautiful examples of Darwinism in action that I have ever witnessed. The strongest and fastest males threw themselves into the truck first. Not far behind were their smaller males. They were then followed by the most attractive females, who were pulled almost instantly into the truck. In last were the wingman grenades, helped in only by their own large legs. I don't get that last sentence. After they realized that there was no incoming. I'm really butchering this. Sorry, I'm seeing double at this point. After they realized that there actually was no incoming, they slowly, sheepishly turned to look over at us as we were sitting there with our balls flapping in the wind, dirty as fuck, while pushing out 3 days' worth of compacted tar and having no business being happy in any way whatsoever, but we were absolutely all dying with laughter. We continued laughing as they drove by, and we sat there smiling and waving at them wildly, like what people do when a cruise ship leaves port. They stared at us in complete bewilderment and just simply started shaking their heads in a way a parent does when a small child gets a pair of new clothes covered in spaghetti and meat sauce. But we weren't kids, and we definitely weren't dirty from eating spaghetti. Fucking classic. Dude, that's a great story, and I apologize for butchering that thing. I suck at reading out loud. Anyways, this podcast has to be over a fucking hour at this point. Yeah, it just turned an hour. All right, this has been a really long podcast with a lot of information. This has been the Encyclopedia Britannica version of the Monday Morning Podcast. You guys all have a good week. I hope you enjoyed the stories. Forgive me for my awful reading. And, let me hype a couple of gigs I got coming up. I'm going to be at Providence at the Comedy Connection in Providence, Rhode Island in August. And the next week I will be at the Punchline in Atlanta, Georgia. And after that, the final day, August 29th, I'm going to be in Stockholm, Sweden. So who the fuck's going to go to that? Nobody from Sweden listens to this shit. So that's it. That's the Monday Morning Podcast. If you want to know the exact dates, please go to my website. It's Bill at BillBurr.com, B-U-R-R. And please sign up for my mailing list on that, because I'm really starting to lose my faith in MySpace. There's just nobody left on there. Like, nobody fucking emails me anymore. So, and I don't want to join Facebook, and I don't want to tweet. So I think I'm just going to basically maybe phase out my MySpace page, and I'm going to just start doing shit on my website mainly. That's the plan. All right, you guys all have a great week. Take care. We'll be right back.